Hello and welcome all. So we organized this particular call today to introduce different kind of programming techniques or introduction how we do programming coding in Fossology. Since Fossology is a very old and a very big project, it can take quite some time to get accustomed how things work here. So to begin with, I have prepared few slides covering these topics. I will not go in too much detail for most of them. I leave it on you to learn from your own. There are wiki available for almost everything, so I have provided the link for that as well. So when you get the slides, you can read through the wiki, check out the links. And still, if you have any doubts and questions, then yeah, we can take it up later. You can contact us on Slack or you can just drop a mail. So to begin with, the first thing when you do something with Fossology or any tool is to install it. So for quite some time, I'm seeing people trying to use WSL and Docker as they are very convenient to start with. But we have been facing issues with them. So if possible, try to avoid using WSL or Docker. If possible, install either Debian or Ubuntu on your machine. If not, at least try to get a VM and install the OS on that. And for Ubuntu flavor, we support only the LTS at the moment, so which includes 1604, 1804, and 2004. So for those, we are very sure Fossology will work, Fossology will install. For others, there can be some hiccup. So it's in your favor if you want to avoid such things. Go with the OS which Fossology already supports and try to install it on a VM rather than WSL or Docker. So for the installation, the wiki is already available. I think most of you guys have already been through it. We also recorded a YouTube video covering the same thing. And if at any moment you feel stuck, something is not working, you can try FO Post install. It sets up most of the permissions Fossology use and the database. So if there is any issue with that, the permission is wrong or something, it should resolve it. Otherwise, it should give you a good error message from which you can connect the dots. And so moving forward, when you are writing the actual code, please do check the contributing guideline for Fossology. And we also have a very well-defined coding style, which is defined for PHP, C++, jQuery, and Twig on the Fossology wiki. For Atarashi project, we have the coding style for Python defined separately. Since Fossology at the moment does not have much to do with Python, we kept it separate. But please do follow the coding guidelines. And whenever possible, add the documentation in the code itself, which is actually very simple. Most of the coding languages share the same traits of documentation in the code. We follow the Doxygen standard if you are very much specific about it. So it actually is a good practice also to do that, and it also helps us to auto-generate the documentation whenever we merge some code in our master branch. And For the PHP coding guidelines, we are using PHP code sniffer. So whenever you create a pull request, do check if all the test cases have passed or not. So most of the time you are going to see this PHP code sniffer error. So just go through the coding guideline and see what error you are seeing in the code sniffer, fix it. Because until unless we see all green in a PR, if there is also a single red, it will cause issues and will cause a delay in merging your PR. So talking about Git, so I found these two websites very, very helpful if you are learning Git. Maybe I can give you a demo. If I can. I can get this link open here. So you can see this is a very nice website. They also have various tutorials at various levels, so you can go through them one by one, see what is rebasing, how you can rebase, what are the commit history, and what is cherry picking, other stuff. And one nice thing about this is it tells you what has to be done in a very good way. It has a very good documentation and a good graphical representation, so you can just follow it. So I would not recommend this if you are already familiar with the Git, because it can be very tedious to go through everything. Then you can refer to the second link. So this does not have any guide, any guided way, but it still give you a good overview how the Git branches and Git commits are. So for example, if I do Git commit and add a file with a Git message, so you see it updates the graphical representation here. So it makes it very easy to understand how things are moving. So I would strongly recommend, if you are not very much familiar with rebasing, amending the commits or squashing, if those terms are very new for you, do use these tools, learn from the net, try it out, because you are going to need this. And also we follow conventional commits, the representation. I have it in the next slide. But I would still recommend going through it, because I have not covered it in detail. You can go through these links. They give you a very nice or in detail view how the conventional change logs are made. And in Fossology, sometimes you might see your branch has become outdated or has merge conflicts. So in such scenario, we prefer rebasing rather than merging the branches. If time permits, I will show you a small demo kind of stuff on this. Then if on your particular PR, you may see some change requests coming in. So instead of creating a new commit every time you are doing a change on a PR, if it is already open, you can follow these steps. So just do your change, whatever is required, add the files what you have changed, do a amend commit. So this will change the commit which you are working on. It will not add a new commit, rather modify the existing commit, and then do a force push. So at the end, in your PR, you have only relevant commits. and try to combine all your relevant work in a single commit. So if, for example, you are changing some UI and at the same moment you are changing its relevant backend code. So since the whole thing needs to work when the change in the UI and the change in the backend are there at the same time, so put them in a single commit rather than making one commit for the UI, one for the backend. It keeps helps keep the change log very clean. So just want to emphasize a little bit on the commit messages. You can read them again for the conventional change log. But ideally, it should look something like this. So it should have your name and your email address, what you are using on GitHub. So to do that, you can use the git config command. And for each commit, so this is a conventional change log. It should denote what the change is. Is it a bug fix? Is it a new feature? So that thing and the scope inside brackets. So this is actually optional, but it would be preferred if you can add it. And then this will be your subject. So as you are writing an email, your subject is crisp and very short. So it should be same here. If you keep it under the length of 50 characters, the whole thing, GitHub will render it very nicely. If you go even a single character over 50, it will give you dot, dot, dot kind of stuff. You will see Eclipse. So after the subject line, add a line break. Otherwise, it is considered as a continuation of the subject. So add a blank line and then write your body. Whatever you want, you can put here. And for a single line, the maximum length suggested is 72, but this is much more forgiving than the subject line. So it's fine if you even overshoot it. After that, just give a one more empty line, and we strongly suggest you to add your developer certificate of origin. This simply says this code is created by you and like it is not authored by someone else. So you are not to say stealing someone else's work. Also, this is a very good habit to do it. It also makes easy if someone is looking out for particular commits, the particular changes, how it came, and if someone has some doubt whom to contact. Every information is there in this particular commit. Okay. Moving forward, one major question you are going to have is what particular file I'm going to edit for this particular bug. So I have added a screenshot for a delete upload page. So let's say you want to do some changes here. So the easiest way to begin with is to find what is the mod name. So each and every UI element have a unique mod name. So you can just copy it. If you are using Visual Studio Code, you can search it there itself. If not, Linux provide you grep, use the grep command and it will tell you which file contains it. You can go there and make the changes. But since this is a PHP code and we use Twig templating, for example, you want to change the second paragraph, it will be very difficult to find from this admin upload delete until unless you know Twig. So for such scenarios, you can also use the content of the HTML if you are going to do some changes in the UI, how it renders. So if, for example, I take this mod name and I do a grep on my machine, it is found in different places. So the first match you see, it is kind of a link or a redirect. So it adds a URL to the UI. And for the third match, it's matched on a PIG file name. So these two are not of my concern if I want to change the PHP code for the upload delete, but the second one, in most of the cases, you will find this thing, name equals to and the mod name. So it can either be defined like this, const name equals to this, or it can be this, the class pointer this name equals to something. So if you find something which starts with name, ends with the mod name, so that is the file which you are looking for. And for other C, C++ code, follow the same thing. Look out unique keywords in the output if it is available for you and you are not very confident which file it is coming from. Just take the output, do a grep. It should land you somewhere good. Then sometime people get frustrated whenever they are making changes, they are not seeing it immediately. So Fossology is, as I said, a very old tool, and the reactive development was not present at the moment when it was created. Like if you see with the React or Angular code now, you just write something, save the file, and immediately your browser updates. So that thing is not available here. You change the file where you have done a Git clone, but the actual file which is rendered on your browser is stored at somewhere under this location. So whenever you do a change, you have to run a sudo make install. But you can save a lot of time if you know how to use it wisely. So with Fossology, everything is so modular. You can compile each agent separately and you can install it separately. So for example, if you are doing a change in a C, C++ code, you can call make build hyphen, then the name of the agent. So this will compile the C code. And then you can just call the make install hyphen name of the agent. So this will install that agent. It will not touch any other code, and you will save some precious time. And in case the changes are in PHP, you can altogether skip the build stage because PHP code is directly run. It's a script, not a compiled language. So directly you can run sudo make install, then name of your agent. But if in case you are making some changes in the database, which I'll cover later, you need to run the fo post install because this script will execute the other script which actually sets up the database. And if the changes are in UI, you might think it is just a PHP thing, so I'll do a sudo make install for that. And you go to your browser, you don't see the change immediately. That is because with PIG, we are also doing caching to increase the rendering time, sorry, to increase the rendering speed. So if the changes are there related to PIG, just run sudo make empty cache. So that will delete all your temporary cache files, and your changes should be updated immediately on the browser. So far, if you have done just the change, you are looking things around, you can get over by running such small stages. But if in case you have done the change and you have done a commit after you have done your changes, so that changes the version of each Fossology agent. So the scheduler will complain you if you have committed, so there can be a difference in the version of the scheduler, the difference of version in your particular agent. So in such case, just compile the whole thing, do the whole complete install, run the FOPost install, restart the scheduler. So consider it as a new install whenever you do a commit. So I just grabbed a screen recording where I made a change in Ojo. So I added a new function. And since I'm inside the Ojo folder, I can simply call make. It will compile just the file which is edited and no other agent. And I can call sudo make install here. And you see it concerned only the Ojo agent. But if you are at a higher level in the root directory, you can call make build Ojo and sudo make install Ojo to make your job easier. Writing the agents, I think I will cover it later. It's going to take some time. Then concerns about the database. So the whole database structure or the schema for Fossology is stored in this particular file, SRCWWUI, coreschema.dat, so which is nothing but a PHP array. So the whole file is divided into four or five different sections, each concerned with a different aspect. So at the top, you will have the tables. So you can recognize them because the array starts with the table dimension. Then comes the name of the table. For example, here it is an agent table. And then comes the column. So it says this is regarding a table which is called agent. And inside agent, there is a column called agent PK. So how this agent PK came into existence? So there are again three parameters. So one is called a description, which is adding a comment to your column, which is very, very helpful. It's again part of a documentation. Then you have add, which is the Postgres command. If someone is running Fossology on a fresh database, how this column should be created. And then you have alter command. So if someone is running an old version of Fossology and there is a change in the database, how that change should be done for that particular column should come in the alter section. Then coming down, you have sequences and constraints. So unlike MySQL, Postgres does not have auto increment. So it uses sequences. And if you see from the previous slide, the previous screenshot, the agent PK is the primary key for this table. So it uses a sequence as a default value to get the next number. So this is just how Postgres works. And again, sequence is structured as sequence keyword, then the name of the sequence, and then this time there are only two sub options: one, how to create the sequence, and two, how to update the sequence. Then you have constraints, which can be your primary key, your unique key, or a foreign key constraint. So I'll tell you about the naming convention later. They are very simple, just the constraint keyword, name of the constraint, and how that is created. And at the bottom, you will find the indexes. So indexes are way to like increase your query speed to submit very in a very bare way. You can read about all these things online. So again, like constraints, indexes are also very simple. Just the index keyword, name of the table to which the index belongs, and the name of the index. and then the command how the index was created or should be created. So if you have not done any significant changes, this is how you connect to your Postgres database. PSQL is a command line client. Then you tell it it's running on a local host with the user FOSSI for the database FOSSology. And the password again, default password is going to be FOSSI. Then I just listed few helpful commands. So whenever you are stuck, you can do backslash D. It will list you all the tables. And if you tell the table name after backslash D, it will list you all the columns, indexes, and constraints inside it. You can do backslash L to list all your databases. When you are running tests, it creates a couple of test databases. And then backslash Q to exit if you can't figure it out. Then coming to naming convention, every primary key should end with underscore PK and preferably have the name of the table. Sequence, again, name of the primary key, underscore sequence, SEQ. Foreign key should be like the primary key, which is it is referring to, but instead of PK, you will call it FK. So from this example, if I'm creating a foreign key on agent PK, I'm going to call it agent FK. Then each index should end with IDX and should contain the name of the columns for which this index is created. And avoid using capital letters in the name of column or the table. Postgres does not like it. It needs to be in double quotes, which you will face unnecessary resistance just tackling it out. So try to avoid it altogether. Then Composer auto-loading. If you are working with PHP, you already know it, but if you are new, Composer is a dependency manager for PHP, and it helps. So for example, if you want to include a class which is defined in a different file, in your current file, you have to require the file. So it becomes very clumsy to keep track where the file is, give it the relative path and do all. So for that, Composer gives you a very nice auto-loading feature. So you just need to open this composer.json file, and you can add the namespace and tell it where it belongs in which folder. And whenever you use this namespace, Composer will include that file for you. And you'll find this common files, library files under src-lib-php. So they, in each and every single PHP file, you can expect these file to be already included. And the common.php also includes your composer auto-loading functions. So if at any moment you feel, okay, this is a very common task in PHP for FOSSology, there should already be a function, do check them first in these PHP files. If not, check the other libraries. If not, then anyway, you will have to create it. Coming to the REST API, in the previous call, we have already covered most of the portion of it. If you were not there, it's available on the YouTube. You can check the link in the Slack or check the FOSSology channel over there. Just to again rebrief, the REST API is divided into several sections. One is called controller, which contains the logic, how a request should be handled. Then you have helper, which are some helper functions or utility functions which help you something doing very common tasks. Then you have middleware, which is a special thing in Slim. I have covered in the last call. You can refer there. Then the models, how the JSON object is going to be responded back for the request, that is maintained here. Then you have a index.php file, which contains the routing information. If a request is, for example, referring to a particular endpoint using particular HTTP method, how it should be routed. Then you have documentation, a standard open API YAML file is there. You can load it on Swagger editor. It will render it in a very nice HTML for you. And if you are doing any change in the REST API, make sure you update it in the YAML file as well. Then I think this is the last slide, some debugging tips. If you are running, working on C++, just learn how you can use GDB or other debuggers. And at some moments you will find your agent is throwing you a segmentation fault. Then how you are going to capture it. So you can go to this wiki link. It's well documented there, specifically for Fossology. It basically says you need to edit the limit conf and allow the core file to be stored. Then under sysctl, you need to tell where the core files need to be dumped. Then you can use the GDB to load this core file and debug if something goes wrong. And if you are working with PHP, Xdebug is a very good debugger for most of the IDEs available. You will find good documentation how you can integrate it with your IDE. Do use breakpoints, because Fossology, if you go with the Fossology's workflow going line by line, you are going to get frustrated and you will miss the actual function you want to debug. So instead of going line by line, just put a breakpoint, continue it till there. It will save you so much hassle. And if you are so lazy, you don't want to do anything, just a dirty trick, what I also used to do sometimes, create a file with 777 permission so anyone can read, write it. And open that in whatever language you are in, C, C++, or PHP. Then dump whatever you want. So at most places, don't dump your debugging message to STD out, because sometimes it can confuse the scheduler, or sometimes it can confuse the PHP if it is setting some headers. You will face different issues then. So the safest way to do is open a file, dump everything you want, and then close it. So this is like a last resort. Okay, so things. I think I covered pretty much everything except the agents. So Vivek, if you are there and you want to take over, you can continue now. Otherwise, I can take the rest of the time and talk about the agents and how you can create a new one.
Yeah, hi Gaurav, I'm very sorry. Yeah, exactly. So today I just wanted 20 minutes of session to demonstrate the uses of React with the UI. So earlier I've already given a session on Angular. So today I wanted to extend that to React as well. But before that, like, is there any question, like anyone want to have any question with Gaurav? Okay, then so I can share my screen?
Yes, of course.
Okay, so you able to get my screen?
Yes, we can see.
Okay, so there is not much of a change in the architecture as proposed earlier. So I hope like most of you are aware of the first session and the architecture that I have proposed earlier, the demo architecture, that's what I mean. So I did the same thing with React, and I just wanted to give a demonstration that how is it possible with React. So this is our usual old diagram, old architecture, which we have followed last time. And this is the same architecture that we are going to follow this time also. There's not much change in it, so I don't think we need any slide or something. Although we can go through this once. So this is our React app. This is test component. Then we have test API service. Then we have REST API, HTTP call. Then we are going to connect with our REST test API. Okay, either we are going to subscribe it or we are going to use the object of the test service class, right? Then we have user card and license card, and at the same time license card can also communicate with the test API. We have loading spinner, which is a common component which can be used based on the requirement. This was the architecture, and let's jump back to our code, and let's jump back to our demo. So first thing first is that once we reload this, we are going to get two different demos in the same demo. One is user and one is license. Coming back, if we will search something in the license, we'll get the license information by pinging to the Fossology REST API. Okay, so last time I've already added this user here, and I think let's add a new user again this time, but this time we can try adding it using React. Okay, accessing it using React. So let's log in and then we can have users. Go to users. We can add users. Then we can add here user like React demo. Then we can something like testing again. And this time we can have something that is same email, rather than using the same email, let's try with something else. Okay, password we can keep it the same. Let's create the user. Yes, so email already exists. I'll try to change the email. I don't. Okay. Yes, so our React demo user is added here, and let's get back to our UI and let's reload it. Let's see how it is represented. And if you can see here, we have this React demo user added successfully. Okay, in the same way I've already shown about the license, let's try it once again, and this is how our demo is working. Let us also take a look at the code base of React. So for React, what I have done is that I have tried to follow the same structure of same architecture, so you won't find a lot much difference. We have something like SRC here, where inside which we have different things like our components, our services, and our interfaces. Then we have environments. Same, coming back to our environments, we have our URL and API token. Then we have service, which handles our service and all the HTTP requests. Then all the components are here in the component. So we have something like common tools as a component, and also something like a test component. If you will see common tools, loading spinner is a common component that I've created here. At the same time, if you will see that we have a, you can see that we have a test component inside which I've tried creating a license card component and user card component. With React, there's a little bit difference when we try to have components. So basically, in Angular, we already had this pre-built infrastructure, but with React, it's up to us where we want to have it and how we want to implement this internal structure of our components. So irrespective of the position of the component, these components are also accessible from any other component without any problem. Okay. Then let's go to our test API test component. So as you have already seen in the architecture, I'm just following the basic design, and machine is pretty slow. Okay. Okay. Yes. So for React, I have tried using component class components, but at the same time, what I found is that functional components are much more powerful in React, but we need to figure out like where we are going to use it and how we are going to use it. Although uses of class component is not deprecated in React, and it will still continue as it is one of the major functionality that was provided by React in the beginning. Uses of functional component is also recommended in these places as well, but we need to keep a good look at the architecture. So let us understand what I have done today. So I have created this component, test component, which is extending component as usual, like the base layer component. Then we have a constructor for this class, and at the same time we have component did mount method for this class, which is triggering the code when the component is launched. So just like in React we had ng init, here we have component did mount, and once the component is loaded, it will try to execute this piece of code. Also, we have render method, which is automatically triggered as a common React behavior to give us to render the complex UI. Okay, and when it comes to React, we don't have different files for HTML and CSS. Rather, we try to manage it all at one place. So going through the same protocols that are provided by React, we have this piece of HTML, and some common tags of HTMLs will be modified here as React does. That is totally fine, but we are loading here user card component and loading spinner component. Similarly, we are checking it when to load user card and when to load loading spinner component. Okay. These are the two conditions which we are checking for. Okay, we have a variable, the state management system in React, which is pretty much handled from the state. When it comes to functional component, it might be much more easier for you. And if you will see here inside our state, we have all our variables which are responsible for changing and creating our UI, and therefore let's take a look at this loader component. So if you will see at this loader component, at the beginning of the constructor, our loader component is false, and when it is false, it will not try to load this loading component, loading spinner component, and rather it will try to go with this part of the code. And here what it will do is that after executing this, it will try to perform a bitwise operation over this piece of code. Now, when it comes to React, it's something that we should understand that React doesn't treat operators always as operands, and we need to like understand it as a operator, like a normal operator. And what it does is that basically once this part is executed, it will try to add up this part. So when it tries to add up this part with this part of the and operations, this part of the and operations is 1, and over 1 this is going to be added, so which is nothing but a piece of UI, and that can be displayed over the screen. This part is a little bit complex, and I think the people who are like practical with React already, and they are already aware of this thing. But let's get back to our loader thing and how we are managing it. So once we start the component did mount is being called, and the loader things becomes true. Upon making this true, what we want to do is that we want to set the state back and change the variable value of this, and we want to render this part again. Okay, so once we set this state of the loader, that is true. The true is set here in this state, and once this state is changed, okay, the state of our component is going to be re-rendered, and it is going to render this part. And at the same time, if we will move forward with our piece of code, it will take up the API URL, and it will create the headers, and it will send a trigger for HTTP call, for which we are using Axios library. We'll take a deep dive into this in a meanwhile. So once this result is generated and our REST API trigger is successful, what we do normally is that we are going to disable our loader. So we make our loader false. We reset our state with the loader. Then we also reset our state with the users, since users were an empty array. And upon the completion of the request, we are going to get the result data into users. Also, we are going to set back the loader state again to false, even if we are receiving some kind of error, and we can log that error. So this is how the loader is being managed, and this part of the code is working. Coming back to our API services, if you can see that test API service is already an object of a class test API service. And why we are using service is that because we want to follow up some OOPS concept to reduce the code redundancy, and and so that we can reuse the same piece of code again and again. And the best case scenario for using any service is what I am trying to show today. So if you will see here, we have this method send HTTP call, which is inside the class test API service, which is exported by default. So when we are calling the component, we are creating the object of this test API service. In this part, we are doing the same thing. We are calling a send HTTP call. We are sending our URL and header to this method, and then we are executing the rest of the part of that. If we will take a deep dive into our test API service, we'll see this method send HTTP call, URL, headers. Okay. Here, what we are doing is that we are trying to use third party library, which is Axios. So there are pre-built libraries from JavaScript. And since React is a library, so React doesn't provide by itself any kind of other library which needs to be triggered. Rather, what you can do is that we can use some pre-built libraries of JavaScript, or we can use some NPM packages. I've already discussed about the NPM packages with the other people. So what NPM packages we get is something like we have a variety of NPM packages like backend, frontend, and for UI for different work. Okay, and there are more than 15 lakhs of NPM packages. So one of it is Axios, which we are using. With Axios, it gives us the power to handle any of the AP, HTTP trigger, and it handles all the data that we are receiving and map, it will map it to the right way and the way we want it. So with XCS library, we are triggering a GET request and then we are sending URL, and then with that we are sending HTTP options. So something similar to that of Angular, we are sending all the headers and that are required. So currently for users, we need a header, something like API token, which is implemented here already. And we are directly sending it there. So this is how our React test API is working. And what we are doing finally is that once we are able to receive result data, we are placing it into a variable named user, then we are setting it back to set state, okay, which is having a user array variable. And once we have that array variable, what we will try to do is that we will try to map each of the data inside that array to the component user card. And if you will see here, we are sending all of our user one by one to this component card component, user card component. And this also is kind of a similar piece of code that we have seen earlier in Angular. So this is how we are sending one user inside the user card component. If we will go inside user card component, we can see here that user card component just does one thing, is that it collects the props, that is properties of the other component who are triggering this. Okay, now what I mean by property is that in basic HTML, if you will see something like class name or like anything like ID, all those are kind of property. So if you will see this component as well, okay, user card component, it is having some properties like key, like user, okay, and all these are received by other component as a props. Again, repeating and coming back to the same place, like we can even use functional components because they are much more flexible and are very vibrant to use. And even though I'm using here class component, please feel free to use any kind of component like functional components. We are receiving all the properties using the props, and inside props, if you will see that we are using user, that whatever we are sending. And since user is a kind of you can say map that contains information like ID, name, and description, we are trying to access all those information. Okay, so with license component, I have also tried introducing the interface, which is following the same thing, but having an interface some of the time gives us an idea about what type of data we are receiving. So if you will come here, you can see that we are receiving all the licenses in an object of license type. Okay, sometimes it is good practice to use the interfaces so that we know what is the information that we are sending to the API and what is the information that we want to receive from the API. Although JavaScript is not strict about using usage of interfaces, and therefore in React it's not very important to use interfaces. So this is just a common piece of common code practice that I would like to tell. Other than that, if you will go through the same piece of code again for like license card, you can grab that thing very well. Also, we have looked at loading spinner is a component, but I wanted to introduce one functional component and come up with a demo on that. So here the loading spinner component is already a functional component, which you can see very easily, like it's not a class, it's a function, and it's very simple to use. Like we can export it by default, okay, and what we have here is a kind of static piece of code which is rendered based on the parent demand. So this is nothing but this is a piece of bootstrap code which is giving us loading spinner. Apart from this, I think same as last session, you can explore back the license card as the user card, and you can have a deep dive into the whole project. I have put this project on Slack already, and it's already available on GitHub, so you can easily explore it. Right, also we have Sahil, who is helping us to get a more deep dive and better understanding of the functional component, so that we can come up with some real good architecture on this. And there are some more students who are continuously helping me with the development of these demo projects. So if we have any doubts or any queries, we can go ahead with that. So
thank you, Vic, for a good overview about the React project.